everybody here this morning. I'm sure y'all have noticed by now we're doing a little renovations to the church. And Lord willing, tomorrow we'll have the carpet installed. And he's supposed to be here, I think, late morning. And we've opened this up. The Lord has brought us a few more gifted folk that have the gift of ministry and music. And so we're opening this thing up to be able to accommodate a set of drums here pretty soon. Move this keyboard out, and I just give the Lord the glory and the praise. Amen. Yes. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Yes. We've been praying, Sister Renee, for the Lord to fill voids. And only God can fill the voids. If man tries to do it, it's going to be inadequate at best. In other words, the calling's not there. The talent may be there, but the calling's not. I want like-minded people that feel and will recognize the call of God on their life and say, Lord, what do you want me to do? And I'm excited about what the future holds for this church. Amen. Now, yesterday, though, not yesterday. That was yesterday with deer season, wasn't it? Oh, okay. The Thursday and the renovations, I want to thank the three musketeers, and they're all here that did this, Brother Marlon and Brother Ronnie, Brother Jimmy Fletcher. You notice I said the three musketeers and not the three stooges, because it was in doubt there for a few moments. Now, Brother Fletcher is a real good carpenter, but if I YouTube, if I had videoed it, we'd have a few hee-haws. I tell you what, it was funny, but it was actually a good time of fellowship.
Amen.
And speaking of fellowship yesterday, what a mighty, mighty men's fellowship we had.
Amen.
I just was rejoicing in the Lord when I left here yesterday, and as always, Brother Earl comes through with a feast, and probably ate too much there, but Brother Fletcher came behind him and just did a wonderful job in devotional, and it was interactive where everybody, all the men would participate, just giving the Lord the praise and the glory, as well as, listen, I need prayer for this, or my family needs prayer, et cetera, et cetera. That's what the church is for. I mean, to come to each other and say, listen, I need a touch of God. My family needs a touch of God. This or that or whatever the case is going on in my life at this time. And we exhort each other. We lift each other up, because the Bible tells us that we are to rejoice when they rejoice and we weep when they weep. So this hand may be real strong today and this one's a little bit weak. We're the body of Christ. You may receive an injury to this left hand or whatever the case, and this right arm has to pick up the load a little bit more. Same thing in the body of Christ. When there is a weeping situation, we weep with them, meaning we're going to lift them up. Amen? This weekend, and I'm not talking about deer season, the opening day of deer season, and I'm not talking about Hallows Eve. I do not celebrate that, and I won't get into that, but if you do go out, you know, those that are watching or whatever the case, be very, very careful, because there is a lot of poison out there that is, it looks like children's candy, and it is not. But no, tomorrow is a very special day to me, and it is to you if you know what that day is. And I'm not talking about Halloween. Those of you that have been your pastor for many years, you ought to know what I'm about to say. It's Happy Reformation Day. Happy Reformation Day. 505 years ago, tomorrow, Martin Luther would take his 95 theses and nail it to the door of the Castle Church in Wittenberg, Germany. Martin Luther was a monk, part of the Catholic Church, but he began to really study solo scriptura, as it is referred to. In other words, the Bible alone. Forget church tradition. Forget what man says. What does the Word of God say? And he began to question the practices of the church of that day, meaning indulgences, where you could quote unquote buy your loved one out of purgatory. That's a lie. There is no purgatory. Number two, you can't buy salvation. Amen. You can't buy your salvation, and you can't buy nobody else's salvation. And Martin Luther would take this to his own peril. I mean, this man was hunted, but he didn't care. He, 505 years ago tomorrow, would nail that to that door. Word of God. But if you were to take it all and condense it down, I'm going to give it to you straight. The just shall live by faith. Come on, church. The just shall live by faith. It's not by works. It's not by anything. You can't buy it. You can't earn it. You can't merit it. You can't work hard enough. You can't. No matter what you try to do, we're tainted by original sin. There's nothing we can do. And Martin Luther would bring that to the church over 500 years ago and would say, no, the just shall live by faith. You go to the Lord with your sin. He's the one that cleans you up. Yes. He washes you in His blood. Yes. He's the one that justifies. Not a priest, not a preacher, not a teacher, but Jesus Christ Himself is the one that justifies the sinner. Glory to God. Glory to God. Now I love to remember that because I make it a study at this time every year to go back and read that 95 thesis, and it is powerful. As we begin this morning, Revelation chapter 17 and verse 14. It reads, "These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them. For He is Lord of lords and King of kings, and oh glory to God, I feel that. They, meaning us, who are with Him, are the called and chosen and faithful." Church, you and I are going to see this. This is what we call the Battle of Armageddon, where they are going to do everything they can, the Antichrist, the false prophet, and the armies of his, to try to come against God and God's army. You and I are coming back according to the revelation on white horses, and you and I are going to have a front row seat in view to the Battle of Armageddon at Golgotha. I feel that this morning. In the Valley of Megiddo, that is where this is going to take place. I love the Lord this morning because I know you and I are on the winning side. It tells us over and over again that you and I are on the winning side because we're in Christ Jesus this morning. Do you love the Lord this morning? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your saints, your children, your church gathered together, the bride of Christ gathered together on this beautiful Sunday morning. Father, we thank you for the cross. We thank you for the precious, precious blood of the Lamb. Lord, we thank you for your word that instructs and teaches us, encourages us, that we know exactly what is to come, how we should live, what we should look for, what we should rest our souls and hearts in. Lord, we cannot have church without you. We ask, oh God, for thy Holy Spirit to anoint everything this morning, Lord, that our praise, oh God, is from our heart extended through our lips, that our heart, Lord, before you is right this morning, that there is no distractions. We ask, oh God, whatever it is, those that are watching or those in this sanctuary, whatever that need is, Lord, you are able. Father, we look to you and you alone for all sustenance, for you are Jehovah Jireh. The Lord will provide. Father, we ask you right now, you said the table is set before us. We ask you, oh Lord, that we will be allowed to come before you at thy table this morning. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Everyone said amen.
Amen. Who came to worship the Lord this morning?
Hallelujah.
Stand and sing. You know, I'm so glad we have the Bible says where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty.
Yes.
I'm so glad we have that Spirit and that liberty here in this church.
Hallelujah.
Not all of them have that.
Right.
Well, you can always find a steeple and a few religious people where there's a preacher on the front still shaking by his hand. I say like a Bible, say a summer revival. Salvation.
Thank you.
You know, our generation, and from here on out, we're seeing things that even the prophets of old didn't witness. They didn't see them. They heard about them. They were seeing them.
That's
they're
right.
All around us.
Praise God.
And one thing I have to know for sure, he said, I'm going to go and prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place, I'm going to come again.
Woo! Oh, yeah, God.
We sing old song, working on a building. I think he's through with it. I think he just put it on that trunk right up now. I'm satisfied.
Till all my fears are gone.
Yeah. Signs of the time.
Jesus is coming again.
Amen.
I'm telling you here, those that are watching, Jesus is coming again. You can see it. That song is so... That song right there will preach by itself, brother.
Amen.
He is coming. You can see what is going on in this world today. But I thank God today, woo, that we are His sons and daughters.
Amen.
No fear whatsoever for the child of Almighty God. Glory to God. Glory to God. This morning as we were before church, I wanted the praise team to take a break. They play their hearts out, and I'm so thankful for them.
Amen.
It's soon, and we're going to add some more up here, glory to God. This song this morning touched my heart. And I just felt like at the end here, that though they could sit down and rest with us, it began to worship and corporately with us. Let this song minister to your heart. Go ahead, brother, when you're ready, please. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Oh,
morning, Spirit. No matter what you're going through, the doctors, the nurses, the prostate, the pundits, whatever the case may be that you're going through and this nation's going through, the family and the community, there is a God that loves us.
Amen.
There's a God that refreshes us. There's a God that refills us. If we will only open up this vessel and say, Lord, I got no answers. I got no answers. But you've got them all.
Amen.
You solved everything at Calvary. Amen. And our faith is locked. It is anchored. His brother was singing so powerfully as he talked about that anchor. That anchor holds, church.
Amen.
That anchor will not let you go. He has not, God has got too much invested in you and I to let you go. Too many people want to try to cut that cord, and some have cut that cord. We may talk about that a little bit this morning. But I'm here to tell you, you may have not have ever heard. Of a swimming anchor. You see, God can do anything. And we might, at one time or another, you may have children today, or grandchildren. There's maybe some in your family that have cut that cable, cut that cord. They're headed in the wrong direction. But I'm here to tell you, at the appropriate time, that anchor will grab them again.
Amen.
That anchor will get them again. Oh, I like that song. Jesus got a hold of my life,
yeah.
And he won't let me go. Oh, he came down into my heart. He came down into my soul. Oh, I feel that. I feel that today. There's a reason why in the canon of Scripture we read about that prodigal son. Oh, glory to God. Went out into that world and wasted. Wasted the inheritance. I got it, Father. I got it. I'll go out and do my own thing. That sound familiar, Stephen? It does to me, brother. It does to me. I got it. I've got this. The Lord says, okay. Okay. Go ahead. Go ahead, boy. There's the world. Go get it. But his eye was always watching.
Amen.
His eye was always watching. And in the appropriate time, that anchor, it was like a fishing pole. Oh, it just reached out and got me. Glory to God. And if you've got loved ones today that you're concerned about, and we've all got a few. I've never met a family that didn't. You keep believing.
Yeah.
You keep believing. God got you, didn't he?
Amen.
Didn't he, sister? God got you. Oh, God got you. He's not going to let you go. You keep believing. You keep trusting in the Lord. Lord God Almighty. You keep praising his name. And that peace that passes all understanding will continue to flood your heart, flood your soul. And that you may be able to stand in this evil day. You will not walk, you will not falter, you will not wilter. Every once in a while you may get knocked down, but the anchor holds. He gonna stand you back up.
Amen.
Look what Job, remember the story of Job? Everything. Job wanted that audience with the Lord. Oh, Lord, give you an audience. You come to him with an honest heart, you go, oh Lord, we gotta talk. The Lord wants to talk with you. He loves that fellowship. He desires to have that. Job, though, Lord, we got to talk. We're going to straighten this out. And Job would then say, I see how vile I am. How vile I am. And the Bible says he was perfect. Meaning he was mature and he lived for God. Might have been the only one on the face of the earth of that day. We don't know. He would say, in front of the Lord, I am vile. But one that was humility, sister. But once man will humble himself by the mighty hand of God, God don't put down, God picks up.
Amen.
God told Job, stand up, gird your loins like a man. Stand up in front of me. You're my child. You are my, oh, I feel if you have your Bibles, please turn with me. A little bit behind the schedule, but I just love praising the Lord. To the New Testament book of Hebrews, chapter 4, beginning at the very first verse. You can keep your seat. I'm going to read quite a few verses. Due to time, I'm probably not going to be able to give the exegesis on every single one, but we're going to try to come close. Book of Hebrews, chapter 4, beginning at the very first verse. Most scholars believe that the Apostle Paul wrote this epistle. I am in that camp, and whether he did or not really doesn't matter because it's in the canon of Scripture. That's all that matters. It's God's Word. But I do believe in studying this great book, to the epistle to the Hebrews, that it was the Apostle Paul, because whoever wrote this had to have a thorough mastery knowledge of two things. Number one, the law. And number two, the new covenant. I don't know who else in the Bible that it would describe better than the Apostle Paul. Chapter 4, verse 1 of the book of Hebrews. Let us, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, that any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them who heard it. For we which have believed do enter into rest. As he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world, for he, meaning God, spoke in a certain place of the seventh day on the wise. And God did rest the seventh day from all his works. And in this place again, if they shall enter into my rest, seeing therefore it remains that some must enter therein, and they to whom it was first preached entered not in because of unbelief. Again, he limited a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time. As it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. For if Jesus had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? There remains, therefore, a rest to the people of God. For he who is entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his own works, as God did from his. Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and the joints and marrow. I want to use for a subject this morning: believe and rest. Believe and rest. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you again, Lord God Almighty. We thank you, Father, for your Spirit, thy presence in this house, your house. Lord, it is such a blessing to be able to praise you, to thank you, to sing praises under our God. Lord, it is such a blessing to be able to open up thy word, to understand a little more about you, the very nature of you, O Lord, and to see ourselves correctly as the word, your word, divides, as your word teaches, as your word instructs. But Father, we cannot do this without the real preacher, without the real teacher, the Holy Spirit. We ask for his anointing on all of our person. We ask this in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen, amen and amen. Believe, church, and rest. Believe and rest. I have found in many situations that I have counseled people, ministered to them, whether individually or a marriage or a family, they're not hypocrites, they love God. Many that I have witnessed to in the prison system. And But the second part is what we a lot of times fail to do. Well, we're believers. The root word is believe. You can't be a believer unless you believe. You're not born again unless you believe in Jesus Christ, what he did at Calvary's cross. Accept him as Lord and Savior. Amen. So you are a believer. But it's that second part, Brother Fletcher, that all of us are still a work in progress. We're not. None of us have arrived. We're still on that potter's wheel. We're still being conformed in the image of Christ. Amen. I want to share with you this morning some good news. So much bad news. I shared some good news last week. I'm going to share some more with you. Those of you that have been following the story, you'll know. Some of you may not. His name is Coach Kennedy from Washington State. Approximately 7 years ago, he was fired from his football coach. He was fired from his job for praying. Fired from his job because after the football game, he did not make it mandatory. No. None of us should ever say it's mandatory. It's mandatory to you and I, we're children of God. But to go to an unbeliever and say, man, you got to get down here. No, no, no. The Holy Spirit, that's his job. The coach would not use his influence at all. He would not try to tell his young men, you must. No. After every game, he would go to midfield. He would kneel down and pray. Just him. He didn't tell the coaches to do it, nor the students in the stands or the parents in the stands. Nothing. You see, sometimes the best thing to do is let your light shine and your mouth closed.
I
have to do that a lot. He would go to midfield. Brother Ronnie, get on his knees. He didn't do it for a show. He was going and thanking God for keeping his players safe, for keeping everyone safe, thanking him for his blessings, that he is a child of God, and that the Lord always anoint me to be your light around these children. Before you know it, his players, many of them, would come gather around him. Oh, and it grew. The players on the other team. Many of them, coaches from the other sideline, would come. Now you had a few parents coming out on the field. Glory to God. You had a few teachers coming out there. And oh, that sounds like a revival is about to break out, don't it? But here comes Satan. Satan will try to do everything he can to thwart a move of God. He is our enemy, sworn and a true enemy of God and all of God's children. He will do anything he can to hinder. Paul would talk about that Satan buffeted me, meaning that Satan would hinder Paul in certain areas of the church, trying to get the gospel to go forward. Satan's always going to try to put up a roadblock, a stumbling block. And he did here. The school district told him, you pray again in front of anybody, you're going to be fired. In other words, you can go pray to yourself. You can pray silently. But he wasn't out there shouting. He wasn't out there praising God audibly. He was kneeling before God praying silently. But because he was doing it in front of other people, Satan's going to raise his ugly head up. Because the Holy Spirit was moving on people, sister. Of a man, a coach, that would humble himself before 3,000, 5,000, whatever the number of people was after the game. It wasn't for show. They fired this coach 7 years ago. This is, I believe it's 7 years ago, 2015, if I remember correctly. God help us. But he said, I will not bow to you. I bow to God.
said we're not going to hear it. This is a case for the lower court. We're too big for that. The thing is, going to open up a can of worms. That's why they didn't want to test for it. This is why, and I don't want to get sidetracked. I don't want to go down this rabbit hole very far. And let me tell you, elections have consequences.
Amen.
Elections have consequences, church. In just a few days, it's going to be a midterm election. Church, go vote. Please go vote. You see, the makeup of the court is different now. The Supreme Court said, we'll hear it. Glory to God, just a few months ago, the Supreme Court sided 6-3 in favor of Brother Kennedy. He has been wronged by the school district in Washington State. Glory to God. And now it just came out this Wednesday that they are to pay his attorney's fees, back pay, and rehire him. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. They did everything they could in the world to stop this man. A simple, silent prayer. Make no mistake, Jesus said, they're going to hate you, but they hated me first. Followers of Christ, those that will say, Lord, I am a believer, not in the system of this world. We are in the world, but not of it. I'm of Him. Amen. I'm in Christ Jesus. Glory to God. And this dear brother would win his case. He's been living in Florida taking care of a sick loved one, but now he's moving back to Washington State to be the football coach again. That's the power of God.
Amen.
That's the power of God. All of hell was standing up against him, doing everything they could, from the ACLU and everybody else, going against this man. He probably felt like, I'm all alone. Wouldn't you? At times. Have you felt that way? At times. But he rested, Brother Fletcher. He rested. Brother Earl, he was resting in the finished work of Christ Jesus. He was resting in the Lord and the power of His might, that there is no court. All courts are subjective to the court of God.
Right.
Hallelujah. Man rules, God overrules. Yeah. And God overruled in this case, church. And it's going to happen more and more and more as, remember, the first century church, they were persecuted too, but they were able to move in what power? Power. Why? Because they believed, church. They believed. The circumstances were bad. The religious leadership is the one that put Christ on the cross. The Romans were just a dirty tool. It was the hard heart of the Pharisees. There are spiritual, quote unquote, religious people out there that are still persecuting the true church. And the true church is the one that cries out to Jesus. The one that says, Lord, King of kings and Lord of lords, I look to you. I don't look to anything else. Glory to God. But the numbers, church, and what I mean by church, I'm talking about blood bought, that believe and that will rest in Him. I've got to move quickly now. But I wanted to drive that point home that sometimes things can look dark. They can be depressing out there. You may have a lot of things coming against you, but if you got God Almighty on your side, you're going to win. If you got God Almighty on your side, I don't think you heard me. If God's on your side, if God is for you, who can be against you? Glory to God, I feel that. Oh, I feel that. Thank you, Lord. I got to drive this point home before we continue in Hebrews. If you have your Bibles, try to hold your spot there in Hebrews and turn with me. people put these up in their home, in their yards. You may have done it too. Nothing wrong with that. These little small signs that you stick in the ground in Psalm 91, you see it in yard after yard after yard. But I've got the focus. The Holy Spirit wants to bring this out again this morning about resting in the Lord. And it's Psalm 91 in the very first verse. Psalm 91:1. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Let's stop right there, this first verse. He, that's you or I, or can be. Remember what I mentioned a few moments ago, that some people don't rest. They're believers, but they're not resting, brother. They're not resting in the finished work of Christ. But there's a secret place. Right there, Psalms 91:1. There is a secret place for all believers that will choose to say, no matter what, I believe in Jesus Christ and what He did at Calvary's cross. It's not in a preacher, it's not in a teacher, it's not in a song, it's not in anything but the blood, the blood, the blood, the blood, the blood of Jesus Christ. There's your secret place, church. I'm not talking about just salvation here now. To be a believer, you're saved. You believe in Jesus and what He did. No, I'm talking about everyday living now. That's what I'm talking about, rest. There's so many people, the vicissitudes of life, and they can be harsh at times. This dear brother Kennedy went through it. They can be hard on you and I. Satan's going to throw them fiery darts. He's going to do what Satan does. But I'm here to tell you, there is a secret place, church. He who dwells, what does dwell mean? Dwell means to stay. You see, you live in a dwelling. It's called a dwelling. That's where you stay. He who dwells, meaning stays in the secret place of the Most High, shall abide. What does abide mean there? Rest. That's where you're going to get your rest. You're not going to get it anywhere else. I had tried in years past. I'm saved, I'm born again, and I'm spirit-filled. But the Apostle Paul is showing us the same thing the Lord showed me years ago through the book of Romans. Paul was an apostle, spirit-filled, born again, being used of God, but he kept failing. He was not abiding in that secret place. And that secret place is in Christ Jesus. Amen. In other words, it's His life being manifested, being lived out in you and I. He said, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Come unto me. Oh, ye who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. I will give you rest. He didn't say the preacher. He didn't say your loved ones will give you rest. If you're not careful, the preacher's going to make you mad, so is your spouse. Or your children, or your grandchildren. Sometimes they don't give you rest, sister. But Jesus. Jesus. I will give you rest. I will take of me, take my yoke upon me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your soul. That's the rest I'm talking about, church, today. We all need physical rest, yes and amen. You know when your body has been overtaxed, you can feel it. And you have to lay down. You have to rest. But too many times, we'll do it physically, but spiritually we're not doing it, sister. In other words, we're not appropriating everything that Jesus paid for at Calvary's cross. We're still trying to fight, this good fight, yes. But it's a good fight of faith, brother. The Word tells me it's a good fight of faith. And my faith is in that anchor. The anchor holds. And the anchor is the cross. It is Jesus Christ in Him crucified. That frees up the Holy Spirit to be able to bring that peace, to bring that joy, to give you that rest, to give you that inner man rest, because Lord knows we need it in this day and time. I know you do. I know you go through the same things, if not more so, at times than I do. We all need the rest of God living. Jesus said in your innermost belly shall flow rivers of living water. The living water, church, is that rest. Think about after you've worked hard in the yard or worked wherever and you get a cold drink of water. How refreshing is it? How refreshing is it? Jesus is in the everlasting, living, running water coming in and out through you and I if we will appropriate it. Say, Lord, like that woman at Sychar and Shechem, Lord, give me this drink. Give me this drink. But he wants to do it continuously. Continuously. He knows what's around that next corner. And he wants you refreshed. He wants you built up, church, this morning. Believers, yes and amen. But it's time to appropriate the rest of what God has. Let me tell you a few sick things that happened. The things that we're fighting, and our children are fighting. Our families are fighting. Illinois, this just happened. Southern Illinois. You talk about reprobate. School, high school. A male coach. A young girl approached him. She's a teenager, 16, 17 years old. She's in high school. She approached him. It was time for PE. She said, Coach, I want to go change my clothes in the boys' locker room. I don't want to change in the girls' locker room. I want to go change in the boys' locker room. Church, this is happening more than you think. This coach said, no. No. It's wrong. You're a girl. The sign over there says girls' locker room and boys' locker room. Well, guess what? She went and told. And now this poor teacher has been suspended. Suspended for saying to a young girl, you cannot go change clothes in the boys' locker room. Superintendent and all of them that will suspend a coach. They are reprobate, church. I will not back down from that. They are subjecting our children to filth upon filth upon filth. The next one and the last one. This is in the District of Columbia. You know, that's a bastion of Christianity, huh? Washington, D.C. One of their elite schools. Now, this ain't high school. Church, this is preschool. What are they, 4, 5, 6 year olds, something like that? Okay. There's a male teacher. I'm going to get in trouble for saying this. He's a male. I'm sorry. I said that wrong. He says he's a male. He's a female. You and I, they're confusing me, brother. This is a woman. Biologically, but she has done a lot of things out externally in front of her classroom to say, I'm a man. I'm a man. These are little fellas. How easily can they get confused? But now it's going to get sick. It's going to get worse. She is pregnant. But she's telling the children she's a man. And you know what the school did? They backed her up. And they sent an email. God help me. I'm getting so angry. I can't find my glasses. Lord, God help me. The school sent an email to all the parents. And I quote, some boys have bodies that can have babies. This is our educators. Some boys have bodies that can have babies. They sent this home, brothers and sisters, to the parents. And then it says, isn't this cool? C-O-O-L. Isn't this something like that, that this reprobates, but that shows you it's going to get worse. These are 4, 5, and 6 year olds, or whatever this preschool is, and what an elite school. They are an elite school. They are teaching a boy can have a baby. Church, you and I and our children, it's going. Men, the Bible says men's heart will wax worse and worse. Okay, we know this. It is sickening beyond belief, but it's here. Face it, it's here. The Bible said it's going to happen. In the last days, perilous times shall come. It's here in front of us. So, church, we've got to look to Jesus like never before. Yeah. Hear me today. Yeah. We have to believe, trust in Him, yeah. And then after you do it, you rest.
Yeah.
You rest. Just like you go into a court and an attorney goes in, he says, I rest my case. Or she says, I rest my case. You rest in the finished work, the legal work that Jesus Christ did on Calvary's cross. The resurrection showed that God, the demands of a thrice holy God were satisfied. Now we can be justified by doing nothing but believing and trusting in Jesus Christ today. Glory to God. But Jesus is telling His church today, my bride, let me tell you, a true good marriage, right before you get married, or let's say during the time of what do you call it, being engaged, you and I are the bride of Christ. We've not went to heaven yet. But it's a special, special time because that bride is growing closer and closer and closer to her husband right before they get married. She's drawing closer and closer to him, trusting in him, resting in him, planning for the future, looking ahead. Church, don't look back. Don't look back. I have talked to too many people that they look back, and that's why they don't rest. Satan torments them and torments them and torments them. They're a child. You're a child of the Most High God. But I've been in people's homes and talking with them, saying, but I did this, I did that. I can't get over this. I can't get over that. I can't get over that. They're born again, but they're not resting in the finished work of Christ. They are not hypocrites. They love God. I'm not putting them down. I've been there. Satan will throw it up again and again and again, and he will do everything he can to rob your peace. And if you got no peace, you ain't got no joy.
Amen.
And if you ain't got no joy, the opposite of joy is the blues all the time, for lack of a better technical statement. And if that happens, you're not at rest. You're at war. You're not at peace. There's a stirring in you, and it's not a good stirring. You're not sitting and resting in the finished work of Christ. Jesus, the Bible said, is seated in it. Seated at the right hand of the Father. He's standing up. And Stephen was stoned, yes. He was ready to receive Stephen. And he showed Stephen. Stephen could see Jesus standing up at the right hand of God. But the rest of the Bible, you'll see that Jesus is seated. Now unless it's time to clean house. Why? Why is Jesus sitting down? It's a finished work, brother.
Amen.
It's finished. Tet Elelestai, it's finished. And so is his bride. Our husband, our bridegroom, has done it all for you and I. And now, okay, you bought me. I belong to you. Well, guess what? He going to take care of you if you let him. Oh, he's Jehovah Jireh, Lord my provider. And this sickening stuff that's going on in the world, we pray, we push back, go vote. But Lord, you're still in control. You're still in control. I know things don't look good, but you go, oh, glory to God. I know you've got it. I got to hurry. Rest. Again, he who dwells in Psalm 91. You're in that secret place. I want you, the church. Jesus wants his children to be in that secret place. To be in the cleft of that rock. Near him. Just like John was on his breast. You see, at the end of the Lord's Supper, he wants his people in that secret place. in that secret place, church, is not to look to the left, to the right, up or down, but look to Christ. And I mean 24-7, I mean 24-7. Look to Him and Him alone. He will take you into that secret place. He will bring you that peace and that rest. You will abide in Him. It doesn't mean that I do it on Sundays only, and then Monday I'm going to go out and do my own thing. No, abide. Abide, the Word of God says. That means I'm staying, I'm dwelling in Him, I'm resting. Verse 2, I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover you with His feathers, and under His wings shall you trust. His truth, Him shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flies by the day, nor for the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor for the destruction that waits at noonday. I think that kind of describes the times in which we're living, doesn't it, church? But the Bible, Jesus, God Almighty, is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I thank God that He's an omnipotent God, all-powerful, omniscient, all-knowing, omnipresent, meaning He's everywhere. Nothing catches Him off guard. And I thank Him for that today. Through His foreknowledge, He prepared us the roadmap that we should not fear. As that song, He has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power of love and a sound mind. But there's too much. The depression, it shouldn't be so in Christians. Yes, there are depressing situations. There is oppression. Okay? But if you're dwelling in that secret place, you're going to the Lord and said, Lord, I've got to have a touch of You. My faith is in You. It's not in the doctors. It's not in anything. We must have doctors in certain cases, yes and amen, but my faith is the one that gives them the breath, the doctors. My faith is in the one that allowed them to have the education and the intelligence to pass medical school, amen. My faith is in the one right now that's going to guide their hands and their minds to diagnose me properly and to treat me properly and cure me properly, not unless the divine providence of God Almighty touches me, amen. My faith is in Him. It's not in the prayer. It's not in the reading of the Word. It's in who I'm praying to and who I'm reading about. And there's a big difference, church. A huge difference. Not in works, lest any man should boast. By faith are you saved through grace. Not of works, it is the gift of God, lest any man should boast. I've got 5 minutes. And I was afraid I wasn't going to finish this. Maybe we'll pick it up again. This, the book of Hebrews, as I stated earlier, is a comparison. It was written to Jews as a comparison between the Old Testament and the New. Alright. It is showing the Old Covenant, or the First Covenant, and the Everlasting Covenant. Alright? Now, what you've got is Paul, if you read the preceding chapter or two, he is illustrating the journey in the wilderness after they were delivered from Egypt. God brings them out, but they were there 40 years instead of 2. It was 38 extra years because of unbelief. That's why, church. They murmured, and when you murmur and murmur, that means you don't believe in the solution. Come on. You can't do both. When we murmur, church, it's tough to have joy. They murmured against Moses. They murmured against Aaron. They said, you brought us out here to die. They complained constantly. I don't want this manna. I don't want this. I don't want that. I'm thirsty, etc., etc., etc. And they began to not believe. So God said, okay, this first generation is going to have to die out here, except for Caleb and Joshua, because Caleb and Joshua believed. Caleb and Joshua would lead them over the Jordan, into Canaan, into the land flowing with milk and honey. But that's not heaven. Too many preachers will preach that, it's just not heaven. It's a type and shadow of your salvation. Stepping over the wilderness stones, the Lord parted that thing. They took out the stones out of the bed of the Jordan, put them on the wilderness side. They took the stones out of the Jordan, put them on the promised side as a memorial. But then the holes that were in the river bottom, they went to the wilderness and gathered 12 stones and put them in the bed. And then when they walked across, you see, the water submerged it. So the wilderness stones, that experience, that 40-year experience is over. Meaning, the past is the past. I, your God, am taking you forward. Don't look back. Go forward and rest in me.
Amen.
Rest in me. I've got you. As long as you will look to me and me alone, you will be in that secret place. But it's all through the cross. It's all through the blood of Jesus. That way the Holy Spirit, which is God, can do only what He can do in your life. Because you and I are going to be up against it. I don't know what's going on in some of your families, not unless you share it with me. But I've heard just about almost all stories. Some that have turned your stomach. But the ones that are making it, that are holding on, are looking into Jesus, the author and finisher of their faith. The author, yes, but He's also the finisher. The finisher. It's finished. A to Z, Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. My faith is in Jesus Christ, His precious blood. He is a resurrected Savior, and He's got me. He's got you, church. He's not going to let you go. And I got to close right now. Brother Fletcher, would you come? Hallelujah to the Lamb. It says it over and over again, church, the Word of God. There remains, therefore, a rest to the people of God. There is a rest for you and I if we will enter in His way. Church, that's not just for salvation. That's for every day. I've got to have the sanctification process in me, and so do you, because this wilderness, these people fell backwards. Paul is telling the church here, even though this was written to the Hebrews, he's giving an example here that the New Testament church is doing the same thing. They were adding law, the Judaizers. Yes, I believe in Jesus. He's my Savior, but you got to do this. So their faith, they were committing spiritual adultery is what they were doing. You can't be faithful to two wives. You can't be faithful to two husbands, can you? No, you can't. And too many, if we're not careful, we can start leaning on another husband. The believer can. If we are not consecrated, our faith is singularly. It's not divided. It must be singular in Christ Jesus today. I want to read this real quickly as I close. It's a song that we sing sometimes, and I'm not asking them to sing it, but the lyrics just hit me last night. The Lord was dealing with me, and I tell my people to rest in me. The news looks bad, this, that, and the other, but the Lord reminded me, the Holy Spirit, rest, rest, rest. Rest, church. You know why we can rest? Because it's assured. Blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. What a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation. Purchase of God. Born of His Spirit. Washed in His blood. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission. Perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst in my sight. Angels descending bring from above. Echoes of mercy. Whispers of love. perfect submission, all is at rest. I, in my Savior, am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. There's your answer, church. There's your answer today. If you want to rest, you rest in Him. There's no other rest. Even though you're going to get knocked around, Satan's going to try everything he can to get your faith in something else. And usually, you look in the mirror, I've got this. No, you don't. He does. He does. Will you trust Him today? I'm not talking about salvation. I believe everyone in here is born again. I believe everyone in this church is born again. If the Lord was working on me to say something different, I'd tell you. But the Lord's working on me. Tell them to rest in me. That means to completely trust in the total. And then you go to that secret place. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Lord, I pray this morning. I know I've not done a good job, Lord, but your Spirit is capable. I know your Spirit has overcome my shortcomings. And I ask, oh God, that your Spirit has touched this church, touched the people on social media, that we, in this dark hour, that we will rest in the finished work of Christ Jesus. That we will not look to anything else but the finished work of Jesus Christ. Reach out, touch Him, Lord. Reach out, touch Him, I pray.
Jesus.
You need prayer, raise your hand. I'll come to you. Standing, but you don't have rest. Your faith has got to be exclusively in Jesus Christ and nothing else. And the Holy Spirit will begin to give you that rest that you need. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Without
Jesus, Jesus,
I would be dying. Without Him, I am saved.
but you know him.
Amen.
Glory to God. That is something worth shouting about. That's worth something that when you leave here, I'm a child of the Most High God. Satan, get thee behind me.
Amen. Amen.
Get thee behind me, Satan. You got no claim on me or my family. I will continue to plead the blood of Jesus. He is a defeated foe at Calvary's cross. Our faith is in him and what he did at Golgotha, and we're not moving. We're not changing by his grace.